listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by LineStar, the top-rated DFS tool set and number one companion for DraftKings, FanDuel, and Yahoo Daily Fantasy. Go LineStar Premium now at LineStarApp.com. Now, here are your hosts, fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.
Hey, yo, what's up, everybody? It's me, Joey P, Joe Pisapia, and welcome to On Deck right here on the LineStar app. It's me, it's you, and it's Chris Meaney, and we're talking MLB DFS, baby. That's what we're doing. It's Tuesday. Yesterday was a frustrating day, although Chris Meaney, you did call another home run right. That means that we are continuing the streak where one of us is right. That is good. Calling home runs, making dreams come true, Chris.
Making dreams come true. Yeah, our boy Ryan Humphreys, I believe, was in on it as well.
Yes, he was.
From LineStar. So a shout out to him who's called some home run shots as well over the past couple of weeks. But yeah, I mean, Jared Eichhoff is... This is yikes. I mean, he gave up 5 home runs yesterday, so he's given up 16 home runs, and they've come in his last 6 starts, and he's failed to pitch 7 innings.
Well, I was
going to
say, in all fairness, Chris, I mean, it would be easier to call or harder to call somebody who didn't go yard in that game.
Right.
With the Diamondbacks and Phillies, 13-8. How many home runs were that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Am I right? 13 home runs? I mean,
yeah,
when's the last time
that happened? Adding Philly in there, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, combined.
Oh, man, wild. I mean, 21 runs scored in that ball game. There were 20 runs scored in the Atlanta Pirates game. There were 13 scored in the Washington-Chicago game. Of course, we got the Colorado effect that had 11 in there as well. So it was a high-scoring night on what was a small slate for sure.
Yeah, well, listen, this slate should have been our you-know-what because we had it on lock. Okay.
Yeah.
And you know what screwed it up? Josh Donaldson's punk ass. That's what screwed it up. All right. And I'm mad about it. And we got tweets about it as soon as it happened. It happened in the first freaking inning, no less. Right.
Yeah.
And, yesterday was a crazy day. I was a chaperone on my daughter's 3rd grade field trip. And then she had her dance recital rehearsal last night. So I was just going all day. So I was driving along Creation, doing what you do when you're a parent. You know, this time of year, you're driving up and down, going all over the place, running around. It's fine. I'm finally settling in. I check my phone and I see a tweet from one of our listeners. He's like, "Oh man, that Musgrove thing." And I'm like, "What are you talking about?" And I look and I'm like, mother effer. Like, I just lost my mind about it. It was so mad. And why is Musgrove getting thrown out? Like, what is this all about? Why was it his fault that Josh Donaldson is a wuss?
It's ridiculous. Yeah, it really should have just been on Donaldson. It was a pitch just in tight. It grazed his jersey. That's it. I know there's a lot going on in Pittsburgh, and there's a lot of people talking about this team, and you know they like to throw at guys, but he wasn't throwing at him. There's really no reason for Donaldson to freak out like that. And I thought he should have been the guy who was tossed. Like, he should have just taken his base, went to first, whatever. You want to say something, fine. Say it on your way, but there's really no need for him to go after him is basically what he did. I mean, he stopped walking to first base.
And the Pirates spotted Musgrove a run in the first inning. It's looking good. Yeah. Everything's going great. Yeah. And then everyone gets their nuts in a bunch over this. And it's ridiculous. It ruins my whole night. It ruined my whole freaking night.
It ruined a lot of people's nights. It was disappointing to see for sure. And how about Charlie Morton? Charlie Morton continuing just to be dominant? 7 scoreless innings, 7K, only gave up 2 hits. He's now 8-0 on the season. He's just been rock solid for 3 years now and one of the most underrated pitchers in the game.
Yes. And look, Sale, another 10 strikeouts for him. He didn't get the win because the Rangers come back.
No W's.
But one thing I will say, no W's for him, no W's for Ryu. It's kind of frustrating there. But one thing we're all over with that Nationals against DeSponge. So they put up 12 against him. So that was a good look there. We talked about them being very cost effective. Ronald Acuna continues to just be red hot. His 15th home run. The guy is just absolutely on fire right now. So that's a positive. But you're right. Morton going to 8-0. That's definitely one of the stories of the night for sure. I mean, he has just been everything you can want. And people were... they were doubting him when he moved over from Houston. A lot of people thought, well, he's going to leave Houston. It's not going to be the same. I would argue he's actually been better in Tampa than he was even last year in Houston. And that's saying something because he was excellent last year.
Well, in fact, he actually has been. So through 14 starts last year, 82 innings, he had a 2.94 ERA and opponents 6.57 OPS. So through 14 starts this season, in 81 innings. He has a 2.10 ERA and a 5.60 opponent OPS. So he has been actually better, which is crazy to think about. Good stuff. I mean, he's one of the better strikeout pitchers in the game too. He's really just changed his game. I remember, you know, looking into him about 3 or 4 years ago and seeing, you know, there's some reports and him talking about changing his style a little bit. And I said, I'm not really completely buying into it. He wasn't really a fantasy pitcher. And man, did he ever just change? Like, and now he's one of the better ones in the game.
Yeah. And look, that's what's exciting. And it's great to see it when it happens to an older guy too, like somebody that you're not necessarily anticipating, you know, kind of towards the latter part of their career becoming as good as they have been. A lot of people were down on him because of the age too. There were lots of reasons. But yeah, I'll tell you, if you made investments on Charlie Morton in season long, you're very happy. If you made investments in DFS this year, you've been very happy. And he was right up there with the big boys, and he proves yet again he belongs in that conversation. So that was yesterday in a nutshell. Stupid Josh Donaldson. All right, so we got to put this one away. I'm going to try my best to compartmentalize everything, put it away, and realize that it's Tuesday. It's a new day. Yes, it is. So let's get after it, and we're going to start with Baltimore. We got the Blue Jays, Trent Thornton, and John Means going at it in Baltimore. Now, obviously, good ballpark factor there. Means one of their better pitchers. On the FanDuel side, you got Means at 7-7, Thornton at 7-9 as the standalone guys. On the secondary pitcher site on DraftKings, looking at these two guys, it's 7K for Thornton, 7-1 for Means. Now, you're seeing a little bit of not like a big giant bump, but looking on the FanDuel side, Vladimir Guerrero is still just 3.0. against the lefty in Baltimore. I don't understand that pricing at all. I want it. I want more Vlad Guerrero Jr. shares. I think there's opportunity there. Outside of that, you know, with Dwight Smith on the DL, I'm not really feeling so much of the Baltimore side of things, although Trey Mancini's price is coming down a little bit. That's a good thing. So what are you looking at? You looking for like a one-off here with a guy like Vlad, or are you looking to actually get involved in this game?
I have a little bit of interest in John Means, actually, from a value standpoint. He definitely stands out on the LineStar app. Yeah, I'm just looking around at some of the pricing, and I mean, you mentioned it. It's just in the middle of the pack. I mean, you have to scroll all the way down on DraftKings to see him over at 7-1, and you know, the same thing on FanDuel at 7-7. I mean, he's allowed 3 or fewer runs in 9 of his 10 starts. It's been 1 or 0 in 7 of those 10 starts. Not allowing a lot of contact either. I mean, 4 hits, 3 hits, 5, 4, 3. That was a start in Boston where he had seven innings, only allowed 3 hits, 1 run. So he's been pretty good. We've talked about him a lot this season. I mean, a 2.67 ERA, obviously maybe a little bit lucky and some regression maybe to come. But this Jays lineup doesn't, we're talking about Guerrero being mispriced, and it's like, who else, right?
Well, that's the thing. And that's why I think it's just a one-off. I'm not looking to get involved in this game much. It wouldn't shock me if it had some, you know, decent offense in it, but I don't know. I can't do it tonight. I can't get in there. In fact, when we go to Philadelphia again, you got John Duplantier and Jake Arrieta squaring off, which I think you might see some fireworks there again. I think it could be 2 days in a row with these guys. I mean, look at the expected run total is what, over 9? Is it 9.5 right now with these guys?
So it's nine. That'll probably jump up. I mean, Arizona is swinging, not just 13 runs yesterday, 8 on Sunday, 6 on Saturday. Friday they scored 8. This team is really starting to come together and score some runs. We know that they can hit lefties, but now they're up against a contact guy like Jake Arrieta. So I mean, we probably won't see 25 home runs in this game, but we could see.
I
think you can continue to get behind him. Obviously the value lies on FanDuel when you get like Adam 100%. Jones comes back in the lineup, 3-2, Peralta's 3-6, Marte 3. That's where I would go,
that's my trio there. It's Marte, yeah. Peralta, Jones on FanDuel specifically against Arrieta for sure. And you have to have Peralta in there. I'm sorry, you just absolutely have to do that. But on the other side of this one, do you have any love for Harper or Segura or Hoskins? I mean, you know, against the rookie there in Duplantier.
Not a ton. I do like Jay Bruce on the FanDuel side of things. He's 3-9. We know that, you know, he gets into these streaks. We talked about that the other day, but I'd still fade him over on DraftKings at 4-8. Not a ton of love. Harper is starting to decrease in price at 4-2, but there's some other spots I think would be better. I do like Arizona though.
All right, now the Mets, Yankees, obviously. So who's going in the early game now today?
I guess it's Vargas and Tanaka.
Okay, so it's gonna be Vargas.
No, it's not. It's Wheeler and Tanaka. Yeah,
it's Wheeler.
It's all screwed up. Yeah, it's Zach Wheeler and Tanaka at 1 o'clock. It is. Yeah, and then it's Paxton Vargas in the late game.
Yeah, I guess I'm not sure how that all worked out or what transpired. Yeah,
why did
they
do that? Why wouldn't they just roll Vargas against
Tanaka? Right,
because
I was looking at it like maybe I'm crazy. I mean, I'm crazy to be confused by it. I'm glad you were too, because I'm looking, I was like, wait a minute, that's not what it was supposed to be. And then, you know, they kind of flipped out, I guess, you know, who wanted to pitch when, and I guess who's a morning person and who's a night person.
I
guess
Jason Vargas. I mean, I saw some snapshots of him a couple weeks ago. He does seem like a night guy.
Well, that's why he's going with the night start, baby. You know, I mean, you really think he's going out there with that that weird junior college professor look that he's rocking sometimes?
he's like undefeated since then. He's been balling up. He's a new man.
He's got the suede. Our elbow patches and everything, I feel like. Anyway, Vargas on the DraftKings side is 7-6 against the Yankees. Paxton's 10-1. You're seeing the continued discount on Mets. JD Davis, by the way, hitting in the middle of that order, 3-6. He's swinging a hot bat right now. You have to pay for Alonso and Conforto, obviously, but I wouldn't pay for Conforto against Paxton tonight. I would not do that. Frazier, his salary all of a sudden has popped way up, if you notice, on DK too. But on the FanDuel side, not so much. JD Davis, 2-5. Todd Frazier, 2-6. Even Ahmed Rosario is just 3-1. So, and Alonso, 3-9. McNeil, 3-0. So it's whether or not you believe in Paxton. Paxton's been spotty all year. If you're looking to the contrarian play tonight, I can kind of understand the Vargas one. I understand the Vargas in the Mets because, I mean, that just seems to be the MO lately. Vargas has been good the last couple outings. I don't know if it's a mechanical issue or whatever it is. So I don't love it, but I think at this point we have to kind of put it in the mix as an option if you're playing multi-entry. And I think it's way more of a FanDuel Mets lineup kind of thing than it is necessarily. And then probably more of a Jason Vargas secondary pitcher on DraftKings kind of thing. What's your breakdown and evaluation of this?
Yeah, I think that's fair. I
7-6 for Vargas on DraftKings as your number two guy, and then you get some Mets pieces. I think that might be all right.
Yeah, I do like Means a little bit more than him, but I understand that strategy. I do like the middle of that lineup, especially the guys that you talked about, JD and Todd Frazier over on FanDuel. I mean, those are free squares on a night like tonight. You want to get some offense. I mean, Todd Frazier at 2-6 and JD Davis at 2-5. That's some real good spots there.
Well, I just feel like the Yankees are going to be very chalky tonight. People will see Paxton.
They will be.
See, you know, a Vargas. And there's nothing
wrong. I don't actually have a ton of interest in the Yankees, to be honest. I mean, against lefties, I know they're getting some guys back to, but against lefties, they rank near the bottom. I mean, they're bottom seven team in terms of WOBA against lefties. They strike out a little bit more against lefties. So I don't actually have a ton of interest in them. You're right. Vargas is hot.
Vargas is hot, but you and I both know the ownership's going to be high on the Yankees tonight.
It's going to be
people
going to
see Vargas.
Yeah,
they're going to be at home. Yeah. And that's why I think as the contrarian play, again, this is a tournament only. This is not a cash game discussion we're having here. This is a tournament only discussion. So please keep in mind the context here, because I think Yankee ownership is going to be higher tonight for sure. And there's always extra juice in the ballpark for the Mets-Yankee series. Not what it used to be, but still extra juice for sure. All right, now here's the one we got to get to right here. Luis Castillo on the road against Trevor Bauer. FanDuel price for Castillo, 9-8. You're going to pay $1,000 more on FanDuel for Trevor Bauer. I am not doing that. I refuse to do that. On DraftKings, it's the inverse. Castillo's 10-4. Trevor Bauer's 9-9. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm taking Castillo on both ends of this. For the $500 more, I'm going to take Castillo, even though it's on the road. And for $1,000 less, I'm absolutely taking Castillo. What do you think?
Yeah, I can't get behind him on FanDuel. I was actually shocked to see that he was the most expensive pitcher over there. I was blown away, to be honest with you. Because
Ooh, Trevor Bauer, you mean?
Yeah, Trevor Bauer. Yeah, like, why is he the most expensive pitcher?
I don't know.
FanDuel?
I'm taking Castillo on both ends of this. I don't get this pricing at all.
Yeah, I don't understand it either. A little bit of value, I suppose, on DraftKings. But, I mean, you're really, really rolling the dice at this point with Trevor Bauer. I mean, he just hasn't been himself. So I may have one share because of on DK only because of the feeling that I think everybody has in the fantasy community that Trevor Bauer is just not himself and he doesn't look good and he's up against Castillo. So it's a really, really tough matchup, but I think I will give the edge to Castillo here. I just, again, I can't on the FanDuel purposes, like we talked about, not getting too cute with your lineup. I mean, sometimes it's contrarian to spend up on that pitcher, especially if he's the most expensive guy and he's struggling. I just don't see it. I think there's more upside in a guy like Patrick Corbin or Chris Paddock rather, or even again in this matchup, Castillo. So he's a fade for me on FanDuel.
Yeah. Well, I'm just looking at that too. And I know, you know, he had that bad start Castillo did in Milwaukee, but I throw that out the window because that's Milwaukee and crazy things happen there. It's like Las Vegas. You got to just throw it out the window. You don't worry about it. And then he had the start against the Pirates where he went 5 1/3. And I get people weren't, you know, excited about that. But then he put up 49 points on the FanDuel side against the Cardinals in his last outing, 8 strikeouts. So for me, that was like, don't worry, everything's fine. And just, you know, no worries about it. And Bauer has been inconsistent. So the way I look at this, it's absolutely Castillo over Bauer on the FanDuel. What a $1,000 difference. You got to be kidding me, bro. Like, I don't get that at all.
No, I don't understand it either. So, I mean, think about some lefty bats. I mean, there's not a ton in Cincinnati's lineup. Obviously, Dietrich Votto is swinging a better bat. I'm not crazy about Jesse Winker, but, you know.
No, I'm not either.
I don't mind Dietrich and Votto in this situation. Like, Bauer's issue has been walks and home runs, and lefties have hit 8 home runs against him at 357 wOBA, 472 slugging. So I think you could maybe, I mean, Votto just hit a home run over the weekend. I mean, Dietrich would be the play at 2.7 for me as a tournament guy on FanDuel to go against Bauer because, 100%. Like, yep. I said, the bombs are just there right now.
Absolutely. And it's still a good ballpark offensively in Cleveland. You get, you know, it's still a friendly ballpark. It's not a bad one. All right, now let's go to the next one. Ariel Jurado, who I've been on twice and twice been right about. I am riding the roller coaster of Ariel Jurado so far. 6 innings in his last 2 starts. He's been very good. He's on the road. It is against Boston, but 37 points, 40 points on the FanDuel side. And in terms of tournament pitchers, in terms of ownership tonight, he's just 6-6. Okay, on FanDuel. Now he's going and taking on Darwinzen Hernandez, which, by the way, if there isn't like a fake Harry Potter wizard sounding name than Darwinzen, I don't know what is. I'm pretty sure he's like a cousin of Albus Dumbledore. Where is Darwinzen Dumbledore? I remember once upon a time when Darwinzen came in and he cast a spell all over the Texas Rangers and all of their bats flew away and turned into broomsticks and they flew around. No, Darwinzen. Really? Anyway,
I was waiting. I when I looked at the schedule this morning, I just knew something was coming from something's you, coming. And it's just classic. It's just it's great. And you know, he's just.
I try not to disappoint.
Nothing special from. Stupid.
They expect it, and I want to give it to them.
and I love it. I eat it up. This is what I'm here for. But yeah, Darwinzen. I mean, 32 walks and 40 triple A innings this season. That is not good. He has some strikeout upside, 59K over that span, but yeah, he's gonna struggle with command. I know it's lefty against lefty. I thought about him at 5-6 actually. I'm like, a lefty pitcher against Texas. Maybe I can get behind this, but there's just absolutely no way that I actually can, because his command has just been so brutal since 2014. You look at it, it's been awful. A ton of walks, so not gonna.
Maybe
go
there. He's not exactly magical. Let's put it that way.
No, okay.
Darwinzen's not magical. So what that means is Ariel Jurado 7-5 on DraftKings tonight. Ariel Jurado 6-6 on FanDuel. I'm telling you,
this going
is
there?
Not a night. I'm going there with a lineup for sure. I'm telling you right now. But because you look at the rest of the slate and it's Fultonevich and Archer, it's all, you know, Martin Perez has been a little up and down. Corbin is the only guy, and we'll get to him in a second, that really pops. It's like, okay, Corbin's the chalk of the night. Probably Paddock right behind him. But I'll tell you what, I'm looking at tonight as being another huge offensive night, and I want the big boy bats, not the little boys. I want the big boys in the lineup. And I'll tell you what, I'm even looking at some of the righties in this lineup too, like Elvis Andrews, even Astrubal Cabrera. Those are guys that are very nicely priced as well. We talked a ton about DeLionel DeShields. I throw his behind back in play here against the Red Sox against the lefty too. So I think there's a lot to like here. And I mean, Jurado's been good enough. Like he has been
good enough. Yeah, he
and
has.
And it's been in Texas too. So if he doesn't there, why can't he do it in Boston? Sorry.
Yeah. Well, the reason he's been doing it in Texas is, I mean, he has a 53% ground ball rate. That goes a long way pitching in Texas, and you're going to carry that over to Fenway. It's a positive. I mean, when you're keeping the ball down half the time, that goes a long way. And you know, he's yet to allow more than 3 runs in a start. I know he's only had 4 of them, but he's been pitching out of the pen. He's deserved this promotion as a starter because he's been good out of the pen. So it's not a bad value play at all. It'll allow you to do a lot with your lineup.
All right, here we go. Mike Fiers, Ryan Stanek was the opener anyway in this one, and guess what, boys and girls, on FanDuel the A's are what? Underpriced. Chris Davis 3-6, Matt Olson 3-2, Chapman's 3-6, Simeon 3-5. So there's your A stack of the night again. As per always, Austin Meadows took a little hit all of a sudden, 4-3. So just a little bit of a discount there on him. Just pointing that out there. You know, just wanted to point that out.
Not on DK though.
Five on DK. Yeah. And all the other guys I just mentioned on Oakland are all 4-1 with the exception of Davis, who's just 3-7. So Davis is still kind of finding his groove. He's, you know, Chris Davis trying to get his groove back here a little bit. Dakota Hudson against Eliezer Hernandez. And again, offense. I just see offense. And wherever I look, I'm seeing offense. Goldschmidt's 4-1 on DK tonight. I think that's a terrific value in this lineup. He's just 3-9 on FanDuel as well. So certainly definitely worth taking into account. Also got Matt Carpenter 3-5 on FanDuel too, which bears witness. So what about this one for you also? I mean, I look at a lot of below average pitchers tonight. We're getting a lot of spot starters, a lot of fourth and fifth guys. And that's the kind of evening where you don't have a Sale, you don't have a Morton, you don't have a Ryu, you don't have those guys. It's wild, wild west as far as I'm concerned. And it's a night for offense, not pitching.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's why I like John Means so much too. You know, the Jays league worst average. So maybe they can get a couple strikeouts and, you know, do enough. And I was trying to, you know, get behind Dakota Hudson here on DK at 6-2, you know, trying to have the same approach as you. It's just, you're really just banking on a win. And I do believe that, you know, St. Louis can do enough to win this game, and Hudson could probably get a win and maybe come close to returning value. It's just where the strikeout's going to come from. He only has 45 and 65 innings. So it really does cap your upside, despite him allowing three or fewer runs in 8 straight starts. I mean, he doesn't give up a ton of contact. Most of it is on the ground, but he's also walking guys and not striking out a ton. So, I mean, a 6K per nine and a 4 walks per nine is not fantastic. I may have a share or two, Joe, just because I want that, you know, maybe I'll do the stars and scrub sort of deal, and maybe he can just go 7 or 8 and get me the W. But again, I may not fully go there because of the strikeout upside, but there's a good chance at least you can take St. Louis on the road for a W.
All right, more offense here. Chris Archer, Mike Foltynewicz. So yeah, a whole lot of more offense. By the way, I think it was 9 strikeouts for Dallas Keuchel in his first rehab start at Single A.
It was. And only 1 hit allowed, I think.
Yeah. So, you know, he's motivated. He's ready. He's like, oh, my God, I need one more payday. I better get my act together here. But at any rate, looking at this, obviously, Josh Bell's still super expensive. Starling Marte, 3-7 on FanDuel. Ronald Acuna, 4-1. Those are two guys I just want to highlight. Acuna's just on fire. He is a fair price. Fair price. Austin Riley at 3-8, very fair price too. So these are guys you pay for, but good return on investment. Freeman went yard yesterday too. If you want to stack up some Braves, I'm perfectly fine with going Acuna, Swanson, Freeman, or if you want to go Acuna, Freeman, and then go to Donaldson, you could do that as well. What's your take on this one? Because I just have a hard time. Pittsburgh is not a stackable team. Like,
they're not. No, they're really not.
I really want to against Foltynewicz. I just can't get there.
I know, and everyone should want to, because, I mean, he's allowed 15 home runs in 8 starts and 5 in his last 2. I mean, he just faced Pittsburgh, and he allowed 2 home runs against them, 6 hits, 3 earned runs. I've seen some positive signs in Foltynewicz, but I can't get there from playing him. And if I'm going to play any Pirates, I mean, you're right about Marte. Josh Bell is super expensive. Brian Reynolds seems to just be one of the safer bats in their lineup. He's moved all the way up to the 2 spot. He's making great contact getting on base. He's 3-1 over there on FanDuel. Doesn't have a lot of pop in his bat, though, so you're kind of capping yourself there. I'd look for some home run guys. Bell, Polanco, maybe Marte. And definitely got to get some Braves in your lineup. 5.5 team implied total is one of the highest on the board. Love them at home, -146. I know Albies has been struggling, hit a couple bombs yesterday. Austin Riley has actually had a bad week. I mean, he's got to come back down to earth He had to cool off. So
Archer's been so hittable this year. So if anyone's going to snap you out of it, I think it's him.
Right. And I've just noticed that Riley's price has just dropped slightly on FanDuel. It's like they won't raise anybody's price, but they'll drop it when there's a bad week. So Riley's actually 3-8. He was 4-1 just a couple days ago. So I think, you know, you can jump on him.
This next one I think is a trap, because Martin Perez at home against the Mariners without Haniger, it looks like a really good play. He's super cheap. He's 6-7. Martin Perez has not pitched well lately. He's become Martin Perez again after all the nonsense and all the things. All of a sudden, the real Martin Perez showed up. I'm running away from this. However, with Mike Leake on the mound, I will have some Twins offense. I just don't like Perez in terms of return on investment pitcher at all tonight.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
It's a giant trap.
Yeah, I get a little bit of love for him on DK, just a tiny bit at 6'7", because we know Seattle strikes out a ton, especially against lefties. But over on FanDuel, I just can't get behind him, you know, to be my one pitcher at 8'2". I would agree. I think he's a trap. But again, I will have, just like I'll have a share of Hudson, like I'll have a share of Means, I will have one or two shares of Perez. But I'm more interested in the Minnesota bats. And how could you not be against Mike Leake? You know,
and it's the thing is like, guy. And people want to say, well, how do you get up there tonight? Well, you get up there, guys like Urado. That's how you get up there to these bats. And how do you get Polanco, Cruz, Rosario? I mean, that's the way to go.
And that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, we talk about chalk, not getting too cute. I mean, this is the best, arguably the best offense in baseball. It really is. And they just got Nelson Cruz back to their lineup. And all he's done since he's been back is hit home runs. So, I mean, Mike Leake has allowed 18 of them. 18 bombs this year. It doesn't matter. Nine against lefties, nine against righties. You can go up and down that lineup, whatever you want to do. You can get them in there. And if you're playing on FanDuel, you just take advantage of some of the discounts. Cruz is 3.5. Max Kepler atop the order at 3.8. Crone is 3.5. Marwin Gonzalez is 2.9. Like it's very affordable. You can get behind any of them. I would have four or five of them in my lineup tonight.
All right. Now, what's your next take on this one? Because you got Freddie Peralta, who obviously pitched very well in his last start at 9 strikeouts for Milwaukee, and it was at home. But Peralta's been another one of these guys too, up and down. He's going against Peacock. Brewers lineup not quite the same on the road. So I think Peacock's going to have a lot of love tonight too. I think there's another guy that's going to be very highly owned. And I don't know if it's wrong, but I don't have a whole lot of faith in him either, to be honest with you. Like
I'm not going there either.
Again, yeah. What do I look at in this game? I'm thinking offense. Like I'm just... It's just trying to get the right bats in here and figuring out how to do that. And it's very doable because of the secondary pitcher market tonight on DraftKings. Even if you want to stay chalky with Corbin or Castillo or one of those guys, it's not or Paddock. It's fine. But I don't know. I think the middle guys tonight are the ones that are going to crush you, Chris.
Yeah, I would agree. And these last three games we've talked about, they're all totals at 10, like Pittsburgh, Atlanta, Minnesota, Seattle, Milwaukee, Houston, 9.5. Like they're just, there's most likely going to be some runs here. So Peralta is definitely a tournament pitcher, definitely somebody to take a shot on the road. Seen a little bit better, you know, from him on the mound lately. You know, his last start, 9K through 6. I mean, that was the only start. Well, he had one earlier in the year where he went 8 innings at 11K against Cincy. That's the kind of stuff that he could do. But against this Astros team, and Houston's actually hasn't been that good over the past couple weeks, and they're not striking out a ton, but they're obviously not the same team with Springer, Altuve, and Carrera.
Well, Springer and Altuve is, you know, well, yeah, I mean, you take three, and not just one, but then three. Massive backs, and it's not, you know, it's tough. Bregman has done all he can, but there's only so much you can do, and Alvarez will help. I mean, I'll tell you what, as a one-off too, just for context, Alvarez is 3.8. We're talking about this, when's it going to happen, but that's on DraftKings. What is he
on FanDuel? He's actually getting respect. Oh, he's not getting respect. 2.5,
baby.
Oh, he's 2.5. My goodness.
2.5. There you go. You ready? 100% ownership. Jordan Alvarez tonight.
And it should be
lefty,
and
it really should be. Peralta.
What do you have, like 26 ownership. Bombs and 70 something RBI? I know it's PCL league, but whatever. I mean, all of you, all the fans out there, the show. And that's the thing with 100%, and it should be with Peralta too. I mean, a 40% hard hit rate for his career, 47% fly ball rate for his career. I mean, that's why we avoid him at home. But when you're going to go in to play a team like Houston, which is a, you know, a pretty decent ballpark as well for hitters. And you have Alvarez, who flirted with 30 home runs and 70-plus RBI and AAA and then hit a home run in his first game. I mean, it should be 100%. It absolutely should be at 2.5.
All right, now, the chalk of the night is going to be Corbin. He's 10-3 on FanDuel. I'm perfectly fine with that. He's 10-3 on DraftKings. So, obviously, you know, everyone's just copying everyone's homework today. But I'm fine with this. I'm fine with going stacking the Nats again. Much easier to do on FanDuel. You want a cheap cash game. Simple lineup. You go with Corbin, you take Howie Kendrick, Soto, and Rendon, and you make it work. If you want to flip out Trey Turner for Rendon, you could do that. It's fine. It'll all work, especially with you guys, you know, Jordan Alvarez at 2.5 and Vlad Guerrero Jr. at 3. There's lots that you can get involved in here and make it work. This, I mean, nothing's a lock, but this is pretty much a lock against Manny Banuelos, I think, tonight. I'm not going the contrarian side of this at all. I don't want to pay any attention to it. Just don't overthink it. Corbin, safe cash game, highly owned tonight. And I'll be honest with you, I like him better against than I do Paddock tonight. I just do.
Well, there's more strikeout upside than, yeah, for sure. I agree. I mean, Corbin has a higher strikeout ceiling. the White Sox strike out more, you know, top three in baseball. I mean, I think they're 28th in ISO against lefties. They're in the bottom seven in WOBA and every offensive category really against left-handed pitching. So I agree. I think Corbin is the chalk. I think he's the guy that you play in cash and you make it work. And then you just move on through the rest of your lineup. You can easily get it done. And you're right about the FanDuel guys. I mean, yesterday, Howie Kendrick, like they're just Washington's
just out there, right, man. Now. They're just there. Junis and Turnbull. This is a pass for me. I see nothing in this game outside of on FanDuel side. You get a little Mondesi at 3-8. That's a nice little one-off if you're looking. But other than that, there's no value in it. And then you got Quintana against Peter Lambert. Now, this one's interesting because Lambert was pretty good out of the gate. And Quintana's been pretty good this year overall. But it's in Colorado. So it's one of those things you kind of throw your hands up on it and you don't know what to do. I'm not going to have either of these guys. I just don't feel like it's a good return on investment, even though Quintana is just 6'5 on FanDuel, which is really, I mean, that's very low. And he's same price as well.
Yeah,
so,
very low. Yeah. It's trying to pull you in. I know.
It's funny. I almost had to do a double take because it's the same price on FanDuel. And I'm sorry, but if I'm going to go all the way down there, I'm going to take your auto. Yeah, I know it's Boston, but I mean, I don't know. I
feel you. That's again, I'll go back to means. I'd rather just spend the extra few hundred dollars and go that way. It's a contrarian tournament play. If you guys want to go that way, we know the upside is there. Lambert may be somebody that we talk about on the road. You're right. His first start was really good. Small sample size, but 62% ground ball rate. That's what you want from a Rockies pitcher. If you go look at his minor league, it's the same thing. 50% ground ball rate.
And that's the thing. It's like, if you're going to go contrarian here tonight, you're going to go wackadoo, go with Lambert. Don't go with Quintana. Because I don't think Quintana's going to win you any money. Go all the way off the board or don't go at all.
Yeah.
And that's the way I would go with this one. All right. Paddock against Tyler Beede. And look, this one's going to be highly owned too. I just prefer spending a little bit more for Corbin with the strikeouts. That's what I prefer. I don't love the Giants lineup, but Paddock's had a great start to the season. I just wonder if we're going to start to see a little bit now of the wear and tear on Chris Paddock on the season. Like, I wonder if as we start to turn the page into June, July, in the summertime, if that starts to happen at all. I think you're getting an indication of it in the last two starts, just 9 innings over the last two starts. I think it's coming a little bit. So he's still been good. Don't get me wrong, but has he been great? No, he hasn't.
No, he hasn't. And we've talked about it before. He's getting hit hard. He's starting to give up some home runs, 5 in his last 2, 7 in his last 4. He's still been fine, but you're right. We have to, pump the brakes a little bit on Chris Paddock. And, he enters this start with a 45% hard hit rate. And that's tops in baseball. It's
and
right
you,
there with Bumgarner and your arena.
On 10-6 tonight on DraftKings, no way. I'll take Corbin for 10-3. I'm sorry. I'm just not doing it. If you're giving a significant discount, it's different. Yeah.
I'd rather spend down on Corbin, save the 300. And, to be honest, I may even just sprinkle a little Bauer just because to be a little crazy and I see the upside, maybe it's potential low ownership. But, it's just the Giants don't actually strike out a ton. They really don't. Sure he'll have a good start and maybe he can get you the W. Beattie's not a great pitcher himself, but I'd rather just save myself the $300. It could actually go a long way with Corbin.
All right, last, Kenta Maeda and Cam Bedrosian opening this one. So who you got in this one? You like Kenta Maeda at 9-7, or is that kind of 8-7 on FanDuel, 9-7 on DraftKings? I don't know. I'm just not excited about it. I feel like once you get to the 9-7 range, you might as well just go up a couple $100 more and get Corbin. What's the point?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And that's the one thing about trying to attack the Angels is, it seems like a pretty decent offense. Again, yesterday, all you have to do is pitch around Mike Trout and Hinjin Ryu would get that W. I mean, there's a guy on first with 2 outs and they pitch to him in the 7th and he hits a 2-run shot. Just pitch around him. I mean, that's it. You can attack this Angels squad. They just don't strike out a ton. And you're just looking at Kenta Maeda. I mean, he's just been a better pitcher at home. He's got a 5.09 ERA on the road and a 1.69 ERA at home. I mean, that's a pretty big difference. So, and they do well against righties. So I'd rather spend up, get the pitcher with the higher strikeout ceiling. And maybe, think about Shohei Ohtani, who's still a decent price. He's 3.9 over on DraftKings. And then on FanDuel, he checks in at 3.5. Cole Calhoun, a lefty against a righty. He went yard last night. He's 3.4. So those are a couple guys that I would think about in the late slate.
All right. It's time to call our shot right here on Deck. And I'll tell you what, as we said before, he should be 100% owned.
Oh, baby.
Jordan Alvarez at just, come on. I mean, come on with the pricing, FanDuel. I love it. I just love it. Come on with the pricing. He is just 2.5, and he's going yard tonight. That's right. Not only is he going to be the absolute steal of the night in terms of price, but he's going yard on top of it. That's where I'm going. So, Chris, where are you going tonight? Where are you calling your shot?
Talk about returning value at 2.5. My goodness.
That's right. He's not only going to be the man, he's going to beat the man. He's going to return the value at 2.5. I can't wait. Woo!
This seems pretty chalky of me, but let's not forget Mike Complete Game Leak is on the hill. So, I mean, he is coming off a pretty strong showing, but I am going to go to Minnesota for my home run. And this is like, I guess he's a favorite of mine. So I'll have to go with Eddie Rosario in the four spot. I was going to go there. Where could you go with Minnesota? You know, you could go anywhere.
I feel like I could tell from when we were talking about that game that you were really into it. And I was going to pick Rosario when the day started. I was like, no, I'm going to let Chris have that one, because I know he's really feeling it and I want you to be happy. That's what this is all about. That's what this marriage is all about.
Host.
It's giving
host.
And taking. And that's why we're still together for all these months doing this show. All right. So from a betting standpoint, what do you like today, Meaney?
All right, from a betting standpoint, let's start up at the top. I'd like there to be some runs in Arizona Philly, so I'm going to take the over. I think there's going to be some runs there for sure. I'm going to go with the under in Cleveland and Cincinnati. That's 8.5 with Bauer and Castillo on the hill. Let's take Oakland on the road. Mike Fiers has actually been pretty decent. I know a lot of guys will want to go to Tampa and get some home runs. Sure, you can do that. I don't suggest stacking Tampa. Fires has actually been okay, but I will take Oakland on the road there. I'll take St. Louis on the road. I'll take Atlanta at home, the Twins at home, the over in Milwaukee and Houston, Washington on the road, and then we'll wrap it up with the over in LA with the Dodgers and the Angels.
All right, so make sure you're getting that LineStar app and make sure you're using the optimizer tool. Get you all the information you need. Again, it's the best out there in fantasy sports for DFS. Also, football is coming too, so make sure you get the Fantasy Football Black Book 2019 edition, DFS chapter by Chris Meaney, relative position value by me, and a whole bunch of brilliant fantasy football minds in that one, so make sure you check that out. Matt Franciscovich, Jake Seeley, Nate Hamilton, and a host of others. So Fantasy Football Black Book 2019 on Amazon, paperback, Kindle, and of course you can get it on iTunes as well. That'll do it for us. You got to follow us on the Twitter machine at Chris Meaney, at LineStar App, at LineStar MLB, and at Joe Pisapia 17. So there's only one thing left to do, and that's step out of the on deck circle and into the batter's box and go yard. We'll see you next time, kids.
You've been listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by LineStar. Hit subscribe, tell a friend, and stay tuned for the next episode from fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.